Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Lord bless you. Good to see you this evening. Trust you had a lovely afternoon. But the evening shall be even better as we're worshiping with the Lord. So stand with me, please. So let's begin by singing, I want that kind of blessing.
I want that kind of blessing.
Yeah.
It's another day he's allowed us to see and to be together and to worship and praise him. And so it is a great blessing to be under God's guidance and within the shelter of his arms. And we do thank him. Let us pray together. Join me as I pray for the word this evening, that it would be a blessing and an anointing to each and every one of us. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I praise you, dear Lord Jesus, for your goodness, for the many, many blessings, so many things and times that we overlook or we forget. But Father, I just pray, bring these things to our remembrance. Help us, dear Lord Jesus, to recognize how you are so integral. You are part of everything we do, everything we say, all the places that we go. Father, you are there to lead and guide and to help us each and every step. And even when we don't know, Lord, what step to take, I thank you, Lord, that we can come to you with our concerns, our questions, our puzzlement. And dear Lord Jesus, you roll the clouds away and you make things clear for us. And so, dear Jesus, I thank you, for you are there every step of the way. So be with us this evening, Lord. Be with those that have gathered, the faithful that are here. And I pray, dear Lord Jesus, that you would give them a double portion, an anointing, dear Lord God, that will strengthen each and every one throughout this week as we go forward in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Turn with me, please, to Isaiah. We're going back and we're using our friend, well, not so much our friend, but we're using Jeroboam once again as our example. And actually, my mistake, I was going to start in Isaiah and then I was going to start in Kings. And that's where I really want you to go. So, pardon me. That 1 Kings chapter 12. 1 Kings chapter 12. We'll be stopping in to visit Isaiah along the way. On Friday evening, if you were here, we took a look at Jeroboam and the problem that he made. You'll remember he's the one that reached out to stop the prophet from proclaiming a word really against Jeroboam and against those that were following him. And as a result, you will recall that his sin resulted in that immediate action of his hand being withered. Now God shows mercy on him. We could continue on with his story, looking at what happens after that. But for this evening's purpose, we're going to take a look at what happened before that particular incident. And perhaps you took a look and you did some extra reading, which would be great. I always encourage you to go back and look at the scripture and perhaps look a little bit further than we have time to do during a service. My message title this evening is Be Thankful for the Way. What we're going to see here is another example, and there are many, but this is something we have to remember, that the Lord has ordained a path and a way for all of his children. To be one of his children, we have to walk in the way that our God has said we should walk. So you can't be a child of God, I'm making a generalized statement here, and some might not like it, but in truth, you can't be a child of God and walk contrary to God. Right? Some would like to say, I can go any way I want, I can do anything I want, and still call myself a Christian. That's not biblical. And that is not according to God's plan. And what we want to take a look at this evening is, I guess, twofold, sort of jumps into my mind. First of all, to recognize that God has made a way for each and every one of us. And secondly, to be thankful for that way. Now, those two pieces don't always find themselves fitting together. Because in our natural lives, and as you're growing up, we, generally speaking, always have someone that is in authority over us. Very few of us will ever have a time in our life when there is anyone on this earth who doesn't have authority over us. It's something as simple as traffic laws, which we are expected to follow, you know, things that we have to do, payments we have to make, all these things. And the problem is that in the natural, when somebody has authority over us and they decide this is the way, the difficulty we have with that is that the person who is in that position of authority may not always be creating or telling us which way to go. They may not always be doing that for our benefit. They may, in fact, be doing it solely for their benefit. Okay, so I hope you're following there with me. Okay? Now, when we think about the perfect parent, by the way, other than God, there is no perfect parent because there's no perfect person. However, if we could imagine a perfect parent or a set of parents, they will, for their children or for their child, they will create a set of expectations. They will create a set of rules. In a sense, parents set a way that they expect their child to walk in, a lifestyle that they expect their child to follow. The perfect parent does so not for their own benefit solely, but primarily for the benefit of the child, right? I mean, when we say to children, don't play on the road, although I confess, as a child, I played a lot on the road. It was a quiet road, and we played road hockey all the time on the road. I rarely see that anymore. Anyway, my point is, when we say to a child, don't play on the road, we say that because we're concerned about the child's safety. Okay. So parents, in the natural, create a path or a way, I'm calling that a way, for the child to walk in, because they love that child, and they, through their own wisdom and knowledge, are hoping to help that child to avoid dangers and pitfalls. Okay. Others that have authority over us sometimes create a way that we don't like. And it's generally because we don't trust the person, or we feel that they are doing it solely for their own benefit and not for ours. Okay? I say that because God doesn't need to make us small or create authority over us. He already has authority over us. Would you agree? God has all authority over us. Okay? So, the Lord doesn't have to make a way for His children to benefit Himself, right? I mean, there's really nothing that we can do that benefits God. God has all things under His control. He can do whatever He wants. He created us because He wanted to, not because He had to. He made this world because He wanted to, not because we told Him that He had to. My point is that the path that the Lord makes for His children is never for His benefit. It's always for the children's benefit. And I start with that to try and make that clear for you and for myself, because if that is something that we truly believe, then it should never be difficult for us to walk in God's path. Okay, so now you got to kind of work your way back through the logic that I presented to you, or the argument that I placed before you, right? If God is always doing things for my benefit, if He's always doing things because He loves me, if He set a path for me because He knows there are dangers on either side, then I should never complain about that path that the Lord has set. I should never try and change the path that the Lord has set. I should actually always be thankful for the path that the Lord has set. I could stop there and give you about a half an hour just to meditate. Wouldn't that be an interesting service? If I said, okay, I've got a timer. It's now 30 minutes. I want you to just think about whether or not your life actually demonstrates what I've just finished saying. Are we always thankful for the path that God has set? Or do we in fact find ourselves occasionally complaining? Do we sometimes look for a shortcut? Do we sometimes question God and say, Lord, why did you have to do it this way? This looks so much simpler. This looks so much easier. If I look at myself, I have to be honest with you, I'm sure there are times when I have said that. And I'm not saying that in a boastful fashion. I'm just saying that is our carnal nature. That is that natural fleshly man that is within us that at times forgets that God loves us so much that he gave us those commandments, that he set the path before us. He told us this is the way, walk ye in it. He did that because he loves us and he's looking for us to be successful. But sometimes, just like children, if you've had any, you will know what I'm talking about. Or if you've been in the proximity of any, you know what I'm talking about. Or if you've ever tried to teach any, you know what I'm talking about. Children often fail to see that the rules, the guidelines, the path that is laid before them as an expectation is for their good. Right? And if you can remember back far enough, there's a really, really, really high percentage chance that you, and I know I, we were those children at one point in time. And what we want to look at this evening is example in the scripture and a reminder in the scripture that when we stray from God's path, the result is catastrophe. But the reason that we're doing it is because we're not thankful for what God has given. And we have to come sort of face to face with that reality. When you are looking, or as Pastor John mentioned this morning, when we start to hear about different groups looking to change the scripture, and we saw very clearly this morning, that's not allowed. Okay? We can't add, we can't take away from God's word, because it's his word, not mine, it's not yours, it's not some organizations or groups. If you don't like it, well, then you're putting yourself on a path to hell, to be blunt. Okay? But you don't have the right, no one has the right to change it. No one has the right to change it. When we want to change it, when we see people who would like to change it, it's because they're not thankful for what is here. So be careful. As we sing in the children's chorus, you know, be careful little eyes what you see. Be careful little tongue what you say. Little hands what you do. Little feet where you go. Let's be careful as God's people. Because if we find ourselves in a position where we think we know better than God, it's really because we're not thankful for what the Lord has in fact done for each and every one of us. Where would you be? Where would I be without the Lord? We all know. We'd be lost, right? We'd be a mess. Some of us would be dead today. Others of us might be in the midst of an addiction. Some of us might be in marriages that are broken. Who knows? These are things that are between yourself, your spouse, perhaps, and the Lord, right? There are all kinds of things that God has repaired, but it is because he has been merciful and helped us to walk in the path that he has set before us. Let's go back now to Jeroboam. 1 Kings. We're going to look at the end of chapter 12. We were reading on Friday out of chapter 13, where we saw what kind of was the end result. But as is always the case, there are things that lead up, okay, to events that take place. And what I want to take a look at here is what happens and what Jeroboam tries to do He actually does do it. And how he's demonstrating a lack of thankfulness. Okay? And this being Thanksgiving, we want to make sure that when we say we are thankful, we're recognizing we're thankful for the way that the Lord has set before us. Okay? So, starting at verse 27. 1 Kings 12, 27. If this people... Now, so, there's a conversation going on here, and Jeroboam is trying to solidify his hold in leadership. Okay? And he says, if this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah. So, Jeroboam, it's too bad their names are so close together, but anyway, Jeroboam, he is fighting to maintain his leadership. He wants to be the top dog, the big guy, the big boss, and he recognizes here if the people go to worship in Jerusalem, which, by the way, God said that's what they're supposed to do. Okay? So this is an example of the way the people were supposed to walk. An act that they were supposed to do. But Jeroboam recognizes is if they do this, they're going to turn away from him. So what is his solution? Okay? Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. And I want you, can underline that one. It's an interesting phrase. It's too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. So he's making himself sound like what? I care about you. I'm worried about your well-being. You know, this is too much to ask. Remember who's asking, by the way. Okay? Remember who's asking. See, sometimes we forget that what we want to do is follow God's way. We're not here to please flesh. I'm going to repeat that. We're not here to please the flesh. I trust that you did not decide to come to church this evening because you wanted to impress or please somebody's flesh. The reason that I pray you are here this evening is because the Lord said, on His day, we come to worship Him. Now, somebody might say to you, oh, that's too much to ask, that you come to Sunday school, that you stay for a morning service, and then that you make the journey all the way back again for an evening service? And look, there's only a handful of people. What's the point? That's putting a lot of pressure on you. That's taking of your time. You see, this is how Satan works. This is what Jeroboam was doing. He was talking to the people, and he was pleading and sort of pulling on their fleshly desires. And in a sense, he was giving them an excuse to not do what God had told them to do. And remember, what I'm suggesting to you is this speaks of a lack of thankfulness. Because what God tells us to do, He tells us to do for our good. Okay? It was not for God's good that the people came to sacrifice in Jerusalem every year. Did God need that natural sacrifice? Of course not. It was for the people. It was for their good. Are we doing something good for God when we come to church? Or when we come to Sunday school? Does this benefit the Lord? He enjoys it. He's thankful. But the benefit is ours. It's our benefit. It's for our good. You see? And so Jeroboam makes it sound like, right? It is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And he sent the one in Bethel, and the other put he in Dan, And this thing became a sin. That's another phrase that you need to make sure you underline or you note. Okay? Going contrary to the way that God has set before us is sin. And you'll also notice here, just as an aside, that what Satan likes to do is he tries to blend false religions and idolatry and the worship of idols and things of the world. He wants to blend those in with Christianity. And that's what Jeroboam does here, right? He doesn't come right out and say that, you know, we're not going to worship God anymore. But he creates a substitute. In a sense, he says, look, you know, you have to go. God says go every year all the way to Jerusalem to sacrifice. Well, that's too much work for you. I wanted to say, I can see Jeroboam saying, that's foolish. Why would you do that? When you can do it right here. Look, here's your gods right here. Why go all the way to Jerusalem? Okay? And you see, when that happens, sin is taking place, and the people are being robbed. Not only of the blessings of the Lord right now, or the joy of the Lord right now, but they're being robbed of their eternal inheritance. They're losing out on everything the Lord has set before them. Okay? And you look how he sort of goes on here, right? Going back to verse 30 there. And this thing became a sin, for the people went to worship before the one, even unto Dan. And he made an house of high places, and made priests of the lowest of the people, which were not of the sons of Levi. So what's he doing there? Again, he's changing the way the Lord said to do things. And when you want to go contrary to the Lord, what are you demonstrating? A lack of thankfulness. Okay? See, he should have been thankful. Look, God has set up this amazing, I'll call it a system, where we have these priests, and the Lord said they should always come from the sons of Levi. What a blessing! We don't have to worry about how this is going to be organized. We don't have to fuss about who's going to be the priest. God told us how to do it. So let's just do what God said and be thankful. But no. We have to do it a different way. Because we know better. Or in this case, Jeroboam seemed to know better. Verse 32, and Jeroboam ordained a feast in the eighth month, on the 15th day of the month, like unto the feast that is in Judah. Notice, copying what the Lord had said. And he offered upon the altar. So did he in Bethel, sacrificing unto the calves that he had made. And he placed in Bethel the priests of the high places which he had made. So he offered upon the altar which he had made in Bethel the 15th day of the 8th month, even in the month which he had devised of his own heart, and ordained a feast unto the children of Israel, and he offered upon the altar and burnt incense. And it's at that point now that God sends the prophet to prophesy that this is not going to continue on. The altar shall be rent. Remember, we read that. And then when Jeroboam tries to stop him and said, get out, we don't want to hear that, the Lord moves instantly and withers his hand. But the whole thing really boils down to not being thankful. That's the emphasis that I want to place on the word this evening, right? Because God recognized, and now let's go to Isaiah. God recognized, and we've seen lately, that in the garden, when Adam and Eve commit sin, that suddenly life becomes a wilderness journey for all of us, right? Symbolically, we see that the children of Israel make that 40-year journey through the wilderness. But, you know, as I was thinking about it, when we sing, my Lord knows the way through the wilderness, and we sang that this evening, all I have to do is follow. You see, there's reason there for us to be thankful. Why? Because my Lord knows the way through the wilderness. See, you don't have to go your own way. As a matter of fact, going your own way is absolute foolishness. Going your own way will lead to destruction. And what we should be every day is thankful that my Lord knows the way through the wilderness. And he made a way. And he tells me in Isaiah chapter 43. Verse 19. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Okay? So I'm reading you that verse. I'm sharing that verse with you because it makes it very clear to me, and I want to make sure you see, that God has made a way. Now, that's not a revelation for us. I mean, you can look at the commandments, you can look at his statutes, you can look at how he has created the earth. I mean, everything around us shows us God has a plan, God has made a way. But this one is a little bit more specific to me, at least, because it says he's made a way in the wilderness. So my life, as I'm journeying, we know there are going to be trials. We know there are going to be tests. We understand there may be times when I don't know which way to turn. That's like being in a jungle. That's like being in the wilderness. But I don't need to fret. I don't need to worry. Here comes the important part. If, little word, lots of meaning. If I follow my Lord. And if I'm thankful for it, you know, when God says, don't do that, we should say, thank you. Not complain, not fuss, not even ask, why not? The first thoughts, the first emotion, the first words that should pop into our head when the Lord says, don't do that, should be thank you. Because in doing so, we remember God said don't. Not because he needs power. Not because he wants to crush us under his authority. He said don't because he loves us. Because it's for our good. So when the Lord makes a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert, he's doing it for you and he's doing it for me. And then as we say, also this evening, we linked those choruses together, right? Follow. I will follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I will follow on. What do we have to do? Acknowledge that God knows better. Be thankful because God knows best. And then follow in the path that the Lord has set before us. In Psalm chapter 40, let me start reading at verse 1. Psalm 40, verse 1. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. And then verse 2 is really the one that I'm focusing on here. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. He hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. See, verse 2 acknowledges again that God has a way. If we're not in God's way, where are we? In a wilderness, or as this particular verse tells us, you're in the miry clay. You're stuck. You're slipping around. You're falling on your face. You are going nowhere fast. No matter how hard you try. Have you ever tried to run in clay? Like real clay? You know, I had this unfortunate incident once, I believe. Only once in my life, where a shallow riverbed. And it didn't look too bad to me. And as I went scampering across, the whole bottom of it was clay. And down I went.
no matter how hard I tried to stay up. That's where we are until the Lord forgives us and places us on a rock, on solid ground. That's what the way is that God said we should be in, the solid ground, right? And verses then in the New Testament establish that or confirm that when Jesus himself says, and you know this verse, right? John 14 and 6, Jesus says this, I am the way, right? Jesus said, I am the way. So, and looking at the rest of the verse, right? The truth and the life, no man cometh unto the Father but by me. So we recognize it's the only way. That's another message, right? My point this evening is that Jesus is the way. He's the path out of the wilderness or through it. He is the solid rock, that solid path that is not miry clay that we get stuck in. And Jesus says, and we are told to simply do what it tells us in 1 Peter 2 and 21. I'm going to close with this verse. 1 Peter 2, 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps. Follow his steps. Follow in the way that the Lord has made before us. And let us remember not to complain, not to fuss. See, some will say, well, you know, maybe when God said, on the seventh day, we're going to rest and it's the Lord's day, maybe God really just meant that an hour of the day is his. Wouldn't that be reasonable? Now I'm sort of sounding like Jeroboam. It's too much for God to expect you to give him an entire day? Come on. Come on. A whole day for God out of seven? A couple hours should be enough. Go back to church in the evening? What? And miss my television program? And miss seeing my relatives? No, you couldn't see them on Saturday. You couldn't see them tomorrow on Monday. Isn't it a holiday? I'm sure it's a holiday. Isn't it a holiday? For most people, it's a holiday, right? You see what I'm getting at, right? You see, we look at what the Lord says, and then because we're not thankful, see, we should be thankful. Thank you, Lord, for setting aside one entire day for us to worship you exclusively. A perfect day. A great day to recharge. A great day to be thankful. To have joy. To gather together with my brothers and sisters in the Lord. To lift up your name. To sing praises unto you. To focus on your word. Thank you for giving us that day. Instead, what do people do? Oh, how come we can't go shopping? How come we can't do this? How come we can't do that? I want to do this. I want to do this. I want to do that. An hour is enough. How about an hour once a month? That should be enough. Once a year? That's even better. Nah, I won't go at all. If I listen to a program for half an hour someplace on the radio or watch something, that must be good. That's being like Jeroboam and the people who followed him. Okay. Let's be thankful for the path the Lord has set before us. Do what it says. Follow him. Follow him. And there shall be showers of blessings. Right? Mercy drops round us are falling. And we're so thankful for the many, many blessings God has given. Stand with me, please, this evening. Let's be thankful. Thankful for all that the Lord has done for us because he loved us so.
and continues to love me so. And when God puts the guardrail up somewhere, and perhaps you've seen that comic, right? The example of the person who jumps over the guardrail, right? You know, and it wasn't, you know, it's not there to stop you from going over, it's there to protect you, so to speak, okay? And so let's be thankful for the guardrails that God puts up. He says, here, this is the boundary. Walk ye in. Let's pray together. Dear Lord Jesus, I thank you, Father, for how much you love me, how much you love your children. So much so that really you have done just thing after thing, blessing after blessing. You hear us, you care for us. Lord, Father, you just have given your entire being to taking care of us. And so many times, Lord, forgive us that we don't appreciate all that you have done. So many times we complain and we push this way and we push that way. But we want to make that narrow way wider, forgetting that you made it narrow for a reason. Forgetting that we should be thanking you for the straight and narrow way. That's the safest place that we can be. And so, Lord, my prayer tonight is simply help me to follow without complaining, without fussing, but help me to follow after you with a spirit of thanksgiving each and every day, no matter what you lay before us. Because, Lord, you've been on this road before us. You've created the path. Now you say, just walk in my footsteps. Follow where I have gone before you. And you'll make it. And you'll be blessed. And I'll protect you. What more can we ask for? Nothing. Nothing. Thank you, Lord, for saving our souls. Be with us as we pray. I ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.